I would like to talk a little bit about the Fraunhofer Society, because maybe many of you have not heard about Fraunhofer. Max Planck is always very known in the field of basic science. Fraunhofer is on the other end of science, so we do applied sciences or sciences for applications. And there are 66 institutes. Most of the institutes are throughout Germany, but we also have institutes in the US, in Asia, in Australia, and we have approximately 17,000 scientists. These are employee scientists and technicians, researchers working in these different institutions. And here I listed the main focuses of these Fraunhofer institutions. Of course, we have a very strong focus on physics, on engineering, aerospace engineering, for example. But we also have a small section of life sciences institutes, and this is where our institute in Stuttgart, the Fraunhofer IGB, is located in. Our institute head, Professor Hirt, is also the speaker of the life sciences within Fraunhofer. And as in this function, we always try to find, of course, new collaborations, to expand collaborations worldwide in order to move more of basic sciences into applicable sciences, which end up either in clinics or in pharmaceutical research. And this just for a brief introduction. The reason why, as Serena phrased it, I'm doing pretty much everything is also a little bit due to the nature of which institutions I'm affiliated with. And so within the Fraunhofer Society, as I mentioned, we focus on technologies, platform technologies, which of course can be applied into many fields. But my main background is in cardiovascular biology, and here very much on matrix biology, extracellular matrix biology. And then in the field of tissue engineering, I worked with heart valves and also blood vessel formation. And I will briefly give you an overview of the things we have done in the past, but also what we are currently working on. And the main focus of my department at the Fraunhofer IGB is to establish human-based in vitro test systems that can be either accredited, be used as the entrance into clinical applications. So we work very close with companies together. They either don't have animal models or they are not allowed to use animal models in order to bring their products into human. However, they must be tested in order to see safety and also efficacy. And what we are using is either IPS systems, so here we can patient tailor systems. We also use with, embryonic, human embryonic stem cells, or adult stem cells, again, either patient tailored or autologous cells, patient tailor cells, or then also primary cells. And this is the main focus actually of the department since the last 10, 15 years before I even came there, to use here patient samples, biopsies, and isolate primary cells. Then these cells are usually put onto a three-dimensional substrate system, scaffolds. They can be either synthetic or also biological. In our case, we use increasingly hybrid approaches where we combine the best of the two worlds in order to then create human in vitro test systems. Here you see the fat test system, we have a bone test system, and we tailor bioreactors. So here we have the engineers. They can specifically for the tissue or organ you are interested in induce then the biophysical signals, strain, stretch, flow, for example, what's important in the system. But we also have our own GMP lab in our department where we can then drive these test systems potentially further into ATMPs, advanced therapeutical products, in order to find their way into clinics. And here we have, again, experience over the last year, specifically in cartilage tissues, chondrocyte cell therapy, and also skin therapy. The most established in vitro model in the department is the skin. We have here a normal skin test systems, for example, but we can also do wound healing. Here you see 3 hours post-injury, 70 hours post-injury. So here you can test compounds, for example, but also genes, cell therapy. You can test different matrix applications in order to study how the system affects skin wound healing. We have an intestinal model established. We can then also bring these normal test systems into a disease in a dish model. And for example, here we have a squamous cell carcinoma model established. We have black and white skin cancers we are working on. We have an adipose tissue system where we can, for example, ask questions of storage. We have in adipose patients the problem, for example, that they store anesthesia and don't wake up after certain anesthesia. So here the question is asked, what happens to these compounds? Are they stored in the adipocytes, in pre-adipocytes? So here again, we work with primary isolated cells from these patients, but also from pluripotent stem cell-derived fat cells. And then we also have established a kidney model in the past and try to also vascularize these models. Our concept, where we base most of our systems, and this is true for the Fraunhofer system, but also for the more basic science we are doing at the Women's Hospital in Tübingen and also at the cardiology department at UCLA, is the philosophy that we look at developmental biology and here in human development, and we try to understand and decipher the cells, but also the matrix. And in this case, the matrix is the scaffold material, the three-dimensional microenvironment in these tissues, in order to either recreate test systems or tissue-engineered organs and tissues for implantation. And as also the title of my talk already said, that one of our main focuses here is extracellular matrix and extracellular matrix proteins. And there are a variety of different matrix elements. And the most basic classification is that you have structural matrix proteins that pretty much give you the scaffolding and also the biomechanical information, which includes different collagen fibers, elastic fibers, but also fibronectins that connect these fibers. We have matricellular proteins such as tenascins. They are very important for development, for normal development, but also for pathological development. And then the big group of proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans, which are very important biochemical factors. They drive, again, either normal or pathological development. One important thing when you look at matrix, when you look at cells, when you look at engineering three-dimensional test systems and organs, is that you do not want to sacrifice your tissue in the developing period, or you don't want to do two test systems in order to sacrifice one for gene or protein analysis for quality control. And so one of the main focuses in our lab, as Serena already mentioned, is also in parallel to establishing these platform technologies to further drive on the optical monitoring system so we can monitor the systems without having to sacrifice them. And here we focus currently on two technologies. One is multiphoton imaging, and the other one is Raman spectroscopy. So we don't have, like in these examples here, we have histochemistry. This is a MOVAT pentachrome stain on a paraffin section. We have immunofluorescence staining on a cryosection, or electron microscopy. We don't have to sacrifice or label our constructs when using these two technologies. The multiphoton imaging is a technology where most of the investigators working with the technology utilize the feature that you can detect endogenous but also exogenous fluorophores based on their intrinsic fluorescence. And these endogenous fluorophores include NADPH, flavins, melanin, the tyrosine, tryptophan, porphyrins. There are more out there. This is just a few of these endogenous cellular-based fluorophores. In our case, we are very interested also that they can be used in order to track elastin and also collagen. And here the collagen has a specific fluorescence called second harmonic generation, which can be tracked, and SHG only occurs in collagen, myosin, and tubulin. So it's a very specific fluorescence without the need to use an antibody to label, for example. Unfortunately, the images are a little bit dim, but I hope that you can see it throughout. And so, okay, thank you. This is much better. And so, as I mentioned, you can use this technology, multiphoton imaging, without the need of any tissue or cell manipulation, so without staining or fixation. And we used the system since the past or more than 10 years now, and we found that by switching wavelengths, so you need a tunable laser in such a system, by switching the wavelength, you can then excite different structures. And in this case here, we have an aortic valve leaflet where we see elastic fibers and cells when you excite at the wavelengths ranging from 740 to 760 nanometer. And when you look at the same histological site, but you switch the wavelengths to 840 or 800 in some of the cases, depending on the tissue, to 860 nanometer, you can excite collagenous networks. And here you see the very nice tissue-typical wave-like bundles in these leaflets. What we also can do with the systems is that we use fluorescence lifetime imaging microscopy, FLIM, in order to then discriminate qualitatively, of course, also again between new versus old collagen, for example, in a test system which has been established, but also when you look here, this is a spheroidal culture of a cancer model, you can detect the onset of the disease with this technology, which is very nice. So you see the switch from a normal cell towards a cancerogenous cell, and what happens to the cell, what does the cell secrete, you can identify through the FLIM measurements. You can also do multidimensional time-correlated single photon counting, and here you can go into spatial resolution and detect single molecules and structures, and this again based on single cell analysis. We have worked since the last 10 years together with Carsten König. He's a professor at the University of Saarbrücken and has a company, GenLab. And this company was the first company to build a tomograph, which is now in clinical use in order to detect melanoma, for example, as a fast screening. This system, or the prototype of the system, we used back then, and this is now 10 years ago, for the pre-implantation screening of tissue-engineered heart valves, where we look at the leaflet structure. So here we have the outflow tract valves. We are interested in the aortic valve. We engineered this valve. And when you look at the leaflet, which is the most fragile element and also the element which does calcify or develop a neointima, you need to verify pre-implantation that you don't have a pre-damaged matrix going into this, in this case, the animal model, but then, of course, also later on into the patient. And here you want to verify with the construct you implant that these structures are not damaged. And therefore, here we did, this is on a whole leaflet. So we invert the valve and screen the leaflets. And in this case, we looked at the elastic fibers of the ventricularis layers, which is the clutch inflow site. And you see a very nice developed elastic fiber system. Carsten drove the system now further, and we have in Tübingen at the university a prototype where we combine these two technologies with the femtogen microscope system, but then here we have the derma inspect option with the arm, with the rotating arm, where we can do in vivo multiphoton imaging on animals, not on humans. It's not certified for clinical use, but here we can screen mouse from mouse rat through the pig, because it's a rotating arm which has a rotation of 360 degrees. And so here we can image different, here you see a biopsy, for example, but then of course also the animal, depending on what you want to image. The heart is challenging because for here you need an endoscopic system, but we are currently working on to get such a system here also established. What you can also use the system for, and this is one of our ongoing projects, is optical reprogramming. So you can use the femtogen microscope for the femtosecond laser pulse driven optofaction. We can then here bring in constructs, for example, also microRNAs, where you can virus-free bring these constructs into the cell by inducing a little hole in the membrane. This hole naturally closes in the cells. And then you can, in addition to the manipulation with the laser, you can directly also image what has happened. You can verify that your construct is correctly in the cell. You can see, based on FLIM, if you induced a change into a disease, for example, or what happened to your cell in this stage. Now I would like to switch to Raman microspectroscopy and what we are utilizing our systems here for. Raman spectroscopy is actually a very established method. So it's been used since decades in pharmaceutical industry for screening of compounds, for example, in manufacturing of medicaments. And it has found its way in the last 5 to 6 years also in biomedical research, and here especially for tracing living cells and also tissues. And so in our lab, we are using Raman microspectroscopy, which is a combination of the spectroscopy with the optical system, so with a microscope, and in our case with the fluorescence microscope for disease diagnosis, but also for diagnosis of specimens before they enter our manufacturing process of the in vitro systems. For example, if you have a bacterial or fungal infection, you don't have to undergo the whole procedure of establishing a month-long skin model because you have cells that are not qualitatively good to go into these systems. So here we can exclude infected biopsies, for example. We can screen isolated cells, but also stem cells and how these cells differentiate towards certain paths. We implement them for mesenchymal stem cell quality controls, but then also for differentiation in our three-dimensional test systems. We then work together with a couple of companies, but also other institutions, the University of Stuttgart, the physics department at the University of Tübingen, in order to establish an in situ Raman system, which can be placed into the OR. So the surgeon, for example, doesn't have to do the diagnostic outside of the OR anymore. We can take the biopsy in this case and combine elastography measurements with the Raman in order to give the surgeon then a hint where is the border zone of the tumor to be dissected. And we are currently also working on to bring the system not only in the OR, but in the patient with an endoscopic system. Again, here with the main focus at this point for cancer diagnosis, but this can also be driven further into the question when you implant your stem cells, for example, are they at the correct site when you deliver them with a catheter system, for example, and what happens to the cells later on or during a therapy. We then also used the system for the in vitro engineered tissues and organs to screen for quality. And here we have one study I wanted to present you because also of the focus of cardiovascular biology, where we use the Raman system in order to monitor cardiac differentiation, since there are no good markers to keep the cells alive in a human system, for example, without labeling. So you have to have a labeled cell for cardiac markers. Most of them are intracellular markers. And so we wanted to ask the question, is Raman a suitable system for this monitoring, which would be very handy for stem cell applications in the heart, for example. And so here we used a mouse system because we also look at later on tissues. And Eva in the lab, she used the Raman system in order to first differentiate murine embryonic stem cells into a cardiac progenitor cell phenotype and then very defined into myocytes. she compared these myocytes then with fetal myocytes, with embryonic myocytes, and adult myocytes from mice, and she found that with Raman we have actually very specific Raman signatures that can be assigned to each of the cell stages. She identified different wave numbers that can be then assigned to certain markers. They are crucial for this developmental aging of the cells, and she could also assign them into or to a certain structural elements that can be shown with regular, with the routine methods used before. What we also could show in the past with Raman, and this goes back to the focus of the title of the talk, which is extracellular matrix. So I presented to you that multiphoton imaging can be used to screen structural elements of the matrix, collagen fibers, elastic fibers, but we are also very interested in screening of the non-structural matrix elements, which are the proteoglycans and glycosaminoglycans, because this is the main component, for example, in developing human embryos or also in mouse embryos when you look at normal organ development. And so here we work together with the lab from Dietmar Hutmacher to identify, can we assign different proteoglycans with this technology? And we used his cartilage system, and he engineers tissue engineered cartilage where we can define the zones, where we also can look at biopsies from regular human cartilage. And here, based on histology and also histochemistry, we could identify with the common methods that we have zones. We have the superficial collagen-rich zone here in yellow, and then we have the middle and deep zone, which is rich on acrican and proteoglycans. And then when we looked at the non-stained sections and also at the biopsies, we could clearly assign, based on the Raman spectra, the zones. So we have here the proteoglycan-rich deep zone in green, and we have the superficial zone, which is clearly separatable from each other. And we then looked into the wave number profiles and could assign the different wave numbers, for example, to collagen, which had been done before in our own group too. But then, based on the literature, we found that wave numbers could be assigned to acrican, chondroidine sulfate, and other glycosaminoglycans. And this is a very nice tool in order to look into developing tissues, but also developing cells. This is a main quality criterion for chondrocytes, for example. When you want to bring chondrocytes through GMP into a patient, you need to show that qualitatively these cells do not change based on the GMP cell expansion process. And this acrican is one criterion for that. To summarize this first part of the presentation, I hope that I could convince you that cells and also, most importantly, extracellular matrix elements can be monitored non-invasively and, most importantly, marker-free with multiphoton imaging and also Raman microspectroscopy. Then Raman microspectroscopy can also differentiate between cell phenotypes. We can assign cell phenotypes to specific Raman bands, and then also distinguish between normal and pathological phenotypes. And most importantly, it's sufficient in order to screen and monitor hard to identify cells, such as myocytes, during development as a quality control. And before, I mentioned also tissue engineering. The engineering tools we have are very important in the lab, and we combine them here with different approaches. And when you look at the approaches available to us, not only in cardiovascular tissue engineering, regenerative medicine, but in general for this field, you always have to make a decision what you're aiming for. Do you want a synthetic versus a biological substrate? Do you want an off-the-shelf approach or patient-tailored? Sometimes they are exclusive. Sometimes you can combine these approaches. And then also, this is a question we discussed this morning, can we make in a certain system for a certain organ a smart hybrid material approach, for example, a timed release of different elements, of different structures, of cells, of small molecules. And in our labs, we are using, for example, electrospinning. Again, this is a very established technology for the textile industry. They're using this since many, many decades to create textiles for bioengineering and has been utilized since the last 10 years. What you need is a high power supply, and then you have usually a polymeric substance. In our case, we use also natural ECM proteins in order to create a fibrillar matrix. And here we have a high resolution image, so you see that out of these nozzles, either randomly oriented fibers can be generated into a mat, or when you tweak it then with certain electrical fields or also a rotating mandrel, for example, you can align these fibers, which is very important based on the organ you want to create. If you want to create a cornea, you need aligned collagen fibers. If you want to have a heart valve, you need random oriented fibers. So here you can tweak your system and then create either implants or in vitro test systems. What we also use is the rapid prototyping or bioprinting approach, which is another way of manipulating your substrates. And here we utilize, for example, biogelatin in order to create capillary systems. I talked before about the vascularization of the right now non-vascularized test systems. So this is an approach to create microvessels, not necessarily blood vessels, but rather the microvessels in order to bring nutrition into your test systems. And we have a couple of applications where we successfully use these technologies for tissue engineering purposes. And one of them was the recreation of the cardiac or the cardiovascular progenitor cell niche in vitro. And when you look at niches in general, the concept of niches, there is always a lot of important criteria to resemble. You need the cell-cell interactions, the stem cell ECM interactions. The soluble factors play a huge role, but also the cytoskeleton from the surrounding cells, but then also your niche cells. And most important, these niches are not two-dimensional plastic static systems. They are three-dimensional microenvironments. And also when we look in developing human hearts, also mouse hearts, we find these clusters of cells, of progenitor cells, they reside in these anatomical sites. And once they grow out of the site, here you have such a cluster, when they grow and develop heart muscle, then they downregulate their stem or progenitor markers, but they also change the matrix environment. And so in our case, we showed that these CPCs, either endogenous CPCs, they can be isolated from the human or the mouse heart, or they can be derived from pluripotent sources, embryonic stem cells, and iPS cells, can give rise to all three of the cardiovascular lineages. They do engraft, they form new myocard, and now the question was, how can we get a high number of the cells? Because this is still the limiting factor of all these approaches, that you get a very low number of the efficient cells. And so when you think about the niches, we thought, how can we recapitulate this environment in order to create more of the CPCs to then go into a cell therapy approach? And what we did here in the mouse system was that we looked at these clusters, and we found through a screen that collagen type 4, an important basement membrane protein, seems to separate the niche and the cluster and maintains these progenitor cells. And so we created a polymerase mat from PCL, and then we used also gelatin in order to give it a stable system that we can manipulate and culture for a certain amount of time. And then we introduced also collagen type 4 as the biochemistry in the system. And then this helped us to increase the amount of the progenitor cells significantly. And right now we are transferring the system into the human. Of course here collagen 4 does not play the main role, so it was a little bit more tricky to recapitulate that, and this is an ongoing work in progress. What we also did is for heart valve tissue engineering, I mentioned before, we look here in developing tissues. We try to identify cells, but most importantly also extracellular matrix structures in order to engineer a sufficient scaffold material for the valve replacement. And again, we utilize electrospinning as a technology. In our lab, we also work on the production of recombinant human proteins that can be potentially produced under GMP in order to be sufficient for implants. And then we combine these methods in order to make a hybrid valve. And here you see such a valve in the reactor where we could recapitulate collagens, the proteoglycans, and also the matricellular proteins which we find in developing human valves. However, one important element of these valves, when you look at the matrix, are elastic fibers. And this is true early on from the development. And so here we initially looked into developing human hearts, and here we have the results from first to second trimester hearts, and then also we looked at adolescent tissues and adult tissues, and we found that these elastic fibers do play a main role in very early hearts. Here we have a seven-week heart valve. This is such a leaflet. Here we have the blood inflow site, and we see the onset of elastin containing elastic fibers. And so we wanted to create a valve which has these elastic elements early on for stability reasons too. And this is work done by Nian and Svenja in the lab. They engineered electrospun matrices which recapitulated from the biomechanics a native valve. They used vascular smooth muscle cells, so here the primary vascular smooth muscle cells from patients, in order to see if their bioreactor system can instruct these cells in order to deposit mature elastic fibers. And we looked then at different methods, but of course also with autofluorescence imaging, and we found that in these three-dimensional constructs, when compared to mature human elastin, we had the increasing pattern appearing compared to the scaffolds without cells. And we also found fibers that contained elastin in their structures. However, we were still not sure if this is a maturing matrix which we generate. And so we teamed up with Elaine Davis from McGill, who is an expert in electron microscopy, especially in the field of elastic fibers. And she found that in our engineered constructs, we have a maturing matrix with collagen fibers, with elastin fibers, and also microfibrils, which is a very important component of these elastic fibers. So you don't only have the tropoelastin deposited, but actually have a developing fiber. And when we compare this here with an 18-week human fetal valve, we see resemblance in the matrix structure. However, when you compare the elastic fibers, we are still at a very early beginning of maturation, but since this is a 6-day in vitro culture with an 18-week in vivo culture, if you want, we have still some room for improvement in this system. And then to summarize the bioengineering part of the work I presented, we feel that CPC niches can be engineered in vitro, progenitor niches in general. You see more and more work here also in the hematopoietic system where people try to recreate the anatomical niche in order to maintain stem cells rather than differentiating them. And so I think it's important to study these three-dimensional environments to get more information on the biomechanics, on the biochemistry, and also the fluidic system, for example, what is needed in order to keep these cells from differentiation in order to make them a suitable cell therapy approach. And then in our case, the human valve development is a good example to show how important it is to study human development, because here we saw also a very big discrepancy to the mouse studies that had been done before. The matrix is completely different and the cells were different in the mouse studies. And so here it was very important to get this insight. Then the identification of cell surface markers and extracellular matrix based on this knowledge will help then again to progress and come up with really smart small molecule therapeutical targets for therapies. And also we feel that the utilization of bioreactor systems, which allow us then to biophysically manipulate the cells, will also help specifically when I think about maturation of myocytes from iPS or ES-derived cells. This is something we are working on. And we see that this biomechanic impact has a huge impact on the cells, specifically when you look at aging. So this work I presented to you was not all done just by one person. There were a lot of friends and colleagues involved. I have listed here. And then, of course, I would like to thank our funding sources, my team in Germany, but also in Los Angeles. And I hope that you have a lot of questions and I can hopefully answer them. Thank you.